Great white sharks are the largest macro predatory fish in the world, with large serrated teeth and a powerful sense of smell. They are perfectly adapted for hunting seals, sea lions, and even dolphins. These massive sharks have only one natural predator, killer whales, who exclusively eat shark livers. But why would a killer whale only eat the shark liver? How are orcas able to extract the liver with surgical precision? And how do we know that some killer whales only eat shark livers? Let me explain. I'm KP, a marine biologist who specializes in marine mammals. Scientists currently recognize at least 10 distinct orca ecotypes throughout the world's oceans. Before we get into these ecotypes, I need to drop a quick content warning. We'll be discussing the foraging behavior of killer whales, and there will be clips of predation. If that's not for you, I totally understand. Just check out this video right up here where I talk about how many of these ecotypes might actually be distinct species entirely. I love the content warnings on this channel. Each orca ecotype specializes in a specific prey. The North Atlantic type 1, Antarctic type C, Antarctic type D, and the resident killer whales all primarily feed on schooling fish like tuna and salmon. Bigs, North Atlantic type 2, Antarctic type A, B, and type B2 killer whales feed on other marine mammals like seals, sea lions, and even other whales. But today we're going to be focusing on the offshore ecotype of the North Pacific and a group known as the flat-toothed ecotype found off the coast of South Africa. The offshore orcas live out in the deep, deep waters of the Pacific Ocean, where studying them can be very challenging. There are at least 300 of these orcas, and their territory ranges from Mexico all the way to the Aleutian Islands. Finding them is often just pure luck. Necropsies on carcasses that washed ashore provided the first clues that these orcas preyed on sharks. A few years ago, an adult female washed up in Alaska, and the cause of death was tooth decay and gum disease. Her teeth had been literally worn down to the pulp. And that's because shark skin is like sandpaper. It is covered in pointed tooth-shaped scales known as dermal denticles. I hate that word. Any of the ickles. I'm not a fan. Which translates to small skin teeth. That's also like, give me the heebie-jeebies. Researchers suspected that these dermal denticles were responsible for the wearing down of the orca's teeth. That was confirmed when a group of researchers encountered a pod of these offshore killer whales near the islands of Haida Gwaii. The orcas were hyperventilating, arcing their backs and diving deep, really deep. Their excited vocalizations were caught on hydrophones, indicating foraging behavior. Then, chunks of tissue began rising to the surface, along with the sheen of oil. The researchers collected as many samples as they could and analyzed them at the DFO's Pacific Biological Station. They found the tissue and oil came from shark livers, specifically the livers of Pacific sleeper sharks, like the one seen here being tagged and released by NOAA researchers. Then, on the other side of the world, a pod of killer whales showed up in False Bay, South Africa. Up until 2015, False Bay was known for its large population of great white sharks, who were world famous for attacking fur seals with enough force and explosive energy to throw their entire bodies out of the water. Actually, low-key, I've always wanted to go see that. Because of this, they became a major tourist attraction for cage diving and wildlife photography. That is, until the killer whales showed up. Specifically, two half-brothers named Port and Starboard. These brothers are easily identified by their collapsed dorsal fins. Port's dorsal collapsed to the left, and Starboard's fin is collapsed to the right, which is how they got their names, obviously. Shortly after these two orcas appeared, great white sharks began washing ashore with their livers seemingly surgically removed. Necropsies revealed bite marks on the shark's pectoral fins, which led researchers to believe that the orcas were grabbing the shark's fins and flipping them over to induce tonic immobility. Now, if you don't know what that is, essentially it is when a shark is flipped on its back. It actually becomes catatonic, allowing the orcas to feed on the livers without resistance. Again, this was all a theory until 2022, when Starboard was filmed killing a great white. This was the first time the predation was actually caught on camera. Until it happened again. Last year, Starboard was filmed killing another great white. This time, he did it all by himself. Starboard grabbed the shark's left pectoral fin and flipped it over. Once tonic immobility set in, Starboard eviscerated the shark. The entire attack took less than 2 minutes. Afterward, Starboard was seen swimming away with the shark's liver in his mouth. The speed and efficiency of this kill is a testament to Starboard's predatory skill. Beyond port and Starboard, there is still a lot that we don't know about the flat-toothed ecotype. For example, the flat-toothed ecotype isn't even one of the recognized ecotypes seen on this particular diagram. Until recently, they were believed to be a subset of the Antarctic Type A ecotype. We don't know how many other flat-toothed orcas there are, and we don't know if they all feed on shark livers. We suspect this is the case because of the way that their teeth are worn down, and that's very similar to those of the offshore orca here in the Pacific Northwest, possibly from biting through the sandpaper-like shark skin. But it has only been witnessed one other time. A 60-year-old grandmother and matriarch of her pod named Sophia. She was filmed ramming a great white at full speed using the same techniques as port and starboard. Sophia grabbed the shark's pectoral fin and flipped it on its back, immobilizing it before feasting on the shark's liver. And then something unthinkable happened. The great white sharks vanished. Cage diving companies and shark tours went out of business because they could no longer find any sharks. Studies found that the sharks ran away from the orcas, hiding in places like Algoa Bay and the eastern coastline. This was backed up by the behavior of great white sharks here on the west coast of North America. In 2009, a research team tagged 17 great whites near the islands off the coast of San Francisco. These sharks spent months circling the islands, preying on elephant seals. That is, until two pods of killer whales swam by the islands. In a span of 8 hours, all 17 great whites disappeared. One dove down to a depth of 3,000 feet and fled all the way to Hawaii. But wait, why are orcas only eating shark livers in the first place? The answer is pretty straightforward. Shark livers are massive. They make up 5% to 25% of a shark's total body weight and up to 90% of their entire body cavity. These livers are packed with a calorie-dense oil known as squalene. It is one of the densest sources of calories that you can find in the ocean. In fact, shark livers are richer in fats and oils than whale blubber. A single shark liver can sustain an orca for days. The rest of the shark is full of cartilage, tendons, and other hard to digest bits. But how do orca know this? How are they able to extract the liver with almost surgical precision? The answer is echolocation. Just like a submarine, toothed whales can produce clicks and whistles, then listen back for the echoes. This works similar to an ultrasound. When orcas echolocate on another animal, they can see muscle tissue, bone tissue, and scar tissue. They can even tell when another animal is pregnant. So when orcas echolocate on a shark, they can easily find its nutrient-rich liver. They can see the indigestible cartilage, and that is how they are capable of removing a shark's liver in such a precise way.
Down.
Oh!